The gentle art of not taking offense and going with the flow. Life is a series of natural and spontaneous changes.
Don't resist them, that only creates sorrow.
Let reality be reality.
Let things flow naturally forward in whatever way they like, Lao Tzu.
The pursuit of happiness is an elusive goal for many people in today's complex, often stressful world. It may seem counterintuitive at first glance, but there is a powerful but little known secret in the pursuit of happiness. It can take a moment to learn and a lifetime to perfect. It is simply this: to not mind what happens, and not react.
The key to not minding what happens is to learn the gentle art of not taking offense at the things that happen to you in the course of your daily life, and not reacting to the provocation. Seen from another angle, it is to have low expectations. In a world where many people grow up with a sense of entitlement, this is much easier said than done because we have baselined our expectations at a high level.
Adding to this is the commercial world that sets a high standard of customer service as the necessary price of selling you something ahead of their competitors.
We all enjoy good customer service and feel we have a right to it, but consider how this might be distorting your perception of reality.
They are only being nice to you so you will give them some money.
The world is really not that nice, in actual fact. Some of the time, even most of the time, our high expectations are met.
But there will always be times when they are not, and then you will be offended and aggrieved and trouble will inevitably follow. How dare you treat me this way? On the other hand, when your expectations are low, you are seldom disappointed and often delighted.
There is an enormous payoff for people who manage to not take offense. Not only do they not go through life feeling aggrieved, they see the world in a much more positive light. When you allow the world to be what it is without expecting it to be different, you access a wealth of intuitive knowledge that you can enjoy and use to live a happy, harmonious life. This is strategic non-action, and it is a powerful yet underrated method of living and being effective in the world. In cultures where action is favored over inaction, like in many Western countries, direct action is considered a virtue while inaction is little more than laziness or cowardice.
There is an advantage in being more subtle and nuanced in our understanding. There is a time for both action and inaction.
Non-action gives access to a deeper intuitive awareness than that which is gained through action, since knowledge that comes through action is obscured by situation-specific reactions. Settle in as I reveal to you the secret of strategic non-action in the pursuit of happiness.
Why you should not take offense? Because it is not personal. The way people act towards you can seem all too personal.
After all, there they are there in front of you.
Their words seem directed straight at you.
It's understandable that you take offense at a nasty remark.
But here is the really important point to grasp: while they might be looking straight at you, what they are saying and doing actually has very little to do with you personally. No, it has everything to do with their own life experiences up to that point.
They are speaking and acting from the attitudes and assumptions that have built up over the course of their lifetime.
You manage to trigger a reaction, and there you are in the firing line. How people react in any given situation is usually determined by how they reacted to similar situations in their past.
When a situation is like an earlier experience, perhaps one as far back as their childhood, then the way that the earlier experience played out will be what happens this time.
It is all about patterns being remembered and reenacted.
This simple rule can be liberating when understood and applied.
It allows you to not mind what happens, to not take it personally, to not be offended. Believe me, ridding yourself of all that negativity is very liberating.
It frees up a lot of mental energy and allows you up to experience whole new dimensions of life that were previously hidden from you, being overlaid by all that negativity. Step out of the crowd by looking around at the world and see so many people have grievances about things that happened to them, years, even decades ago.
Without even realizing it, they have created a victim identity for themselves from these accumulated grievances.
Like a sulky child, they go about telling anyone who will listen just how badly the world has treated them. But we all have the potential to control how we think about what happens to us, even if we can't control the forces that caused those events.
It makes much more sense to construct a positive identity for oneself, projections of their inner world.
It has been wisely said that a person's inner world is their primary reality.
What happens outside is your secondary reality.
So here we all are, the way we think and feel being the sum total of everything that has happened in the course of our lives, plus a set of innate personality factors that we inherited from our parents.
Most people think the outside world is their primary reality.
But once you understand which way around it really is, you can begin to make some very positive changes. When you look out at the world, everything you see, hear, taste, touch and experience is filtered through the lens of your unique worldview. The things that you experience that fits with that pre-existing worldview will be recognized and assimilated.
What does not fit will automatically be filtered out and ignored.
We only assimilate a small proportion of what our senses actually receive. We do not just filter the world through the lens of our experiences, we actively project our worldview out, so what we see and hear is what we expect to be there, whether it is there or not. In this way, we actively create the world we live in. All of this happens quite unconsciously, and we have been doing it since we were children, learning about the world for the first time. For example, when I am standing at the speaker's dais in a lecture theater with 100 students before me, I am conscious that no two people in that room will be having the same experience of that lecture and of me. We might all be seeing the same four walls, but almost everything else will be created by each person's past experiences.
One student may have a positive impression of me because I remind her of her father with whom she enjoys a positive relationship. Another student may dislike me because I remind him of the father that he has been arguing with. I do not take offense at those who dislike me. I cannot control what earlier life experiences people may have had.
I can only control how positive and exciting is the energy that I project out into the room, becoming more detached. When you understand that the way people react to you has more to do with their own, pre-existing attitudes than anything that you might have done or said, you can become more detached from those reactions.
You are well on your way to not taking offense, not minding what happens. You become like a bullfighter that deftly steps aside as the bull rushes past, or you acquire a second skin of Teflon that nothing can stick to.
Instead of saying "I can't believe you just said that," or "I'm so offended by what you just did," you understand that it came from a wounded place within the other person, and that it is the circumstances of the current situation that caused the reaction, not you personally.
This certainly does not mean that you should become a doormat or a punching bag for damaged people. You should certainly not allow yourself to be harmed by them. It can be made quite clear that you will not tolerate that behavior. No, you are simply not allowing that person to upset you. Healing occurs. When you do not react to the negativity of others, a curious transformation takes place.
When force is not met with force, their offensive falls flat on its face like a person who throws a punch, misses, and then falls over. When the person does not get the expected reaction, it shines a spotlight on their own behavior. It is possible, even likely, that they become aware that this was perhaps not the best way to behave.
You do not need to say or do anything for this beneficial effect to occur.
You just need to not react. Strategic non-action. Non-action can be understood as an aspect of going with the flow, not resisting the larger forces that govern a world of which we are a small part. Non-action acknowledges that events are governed by the laws of nature, and it is often best to simply allow those laws to operate and play out in their own time, in their own way. Taking action often amounts to interference which creates its own problems. Non-action can help us towards our goals by encouraging patience and taking the long view. Humanistic psychology says that it is within our reach to create the life we want for ourselves.
As we think and believe, so we create our world.
This is indeed true, but only up to a point.
We can transform our lives in goal-fulfilling ways, but the transformation is relatively slow, its progress measured in months and years. For every action, an equal and opposite reaction.
We know that for every action there is an equal and opposite reaction, at least we know this is true in physics if we did not sleep through that class in school. Less recognized is the truth of this law in human affairs. Physicists refer to it as Newton's third law. Just as in the world of inanimate objects, in the world of people, when we do things we also get a reaction. This then causes its own reaction, and a pendulum-like cycle is set up.
Think of how people get into feuds with each other.
Strategic non-action recognizes the danger of this pattern of behavior and offers the only means of avoiding it. Non-action gives others nothing to react against. This is the essence of the ancient Chinese concept of wu-wei, as expressed in Lao Tzu's classic Tao Te Ching. First published around 2,500 years ago, it is probably the oldest book still in print, a testimony to the wisdom of practicing non-action. Wu-wei literally means without effort.
It describes natural action that occurs without contrivance or effort. It simply happens. Think of how plants and animals grow, rivers flow and planets orbit.
No one makes them do this, it simply happens without effort or control in accordance with the laws of nature. This is the effortlessness implied by wu-wei. Such action is what we should strive to emulate, while avoiding the kind of action that causes counter-reactions.
Let us now look at the ways that wu-wei, or strategic non-action, can be understood and practiced.
To become a master of strategic non-action, cultivate and practice these principles. Limit your impact on the world to avoid creating counter-reactions that become problems in their own right. Allow a clear flow of information to enter your senses from a world that is not busy reacting to you.
This leads to a deeper, intuitive awareness of reality.
Further improve the flow of clear information by shedding orthodox ideas that stifle new ways of thinking. Acknowledge that problems have a way of resolving themselves in time and that action should be limited to guiding the situation to resolve itself. Adopt a humble posture and allow natural forces to advance you, knowing that what was low becomes high, what was in the background comes to the foreground. Recognize and respect that there is an informing principle in nature. Align your awareness with this principle and you will be in harmony with nature. Being adaptable in a changing world is about not becoming too specialized, too dependent on a specific set of circumstances for your survival.
Simplicity is the key. Understand that what you resist will persist. By paying attention to a problem, you strengthen it. Some problems are best left alone to fade away.
Avoid the extremes of seeking revenge on the one hand and being a doormat on the other.
Find the middle path by choosing a course of strategic minimal action that neutralizes conflict and produces no further reactions.
Emulate a child, live in the now, be adaptable, non-judgmental, stay in touch with your original nature and the reality of your world as it is, not as you believe it should be. Avoid meeting tough problems head-on, solve them progressively by focusing on the weakest aspect first, then the next and the next.
Be like the stream that flows around obstacles on its way to its goal.
Understand that it is much easier to influence people and events when they are at the beginning. Be the kind of leader that gives people the resources they need to grow, the space in which to grow, and then step back and leave to get on with it. Respect their need for freedom and self-determination by not imposing unnecessary rules.
Learn patience in all things, it is rightly said that patience is the paramount virtue. Thanks for listening to The Gentle Art of Not Taking Offense. Find out more in the description of this video.